It is so good to see your love from Tammy and our family. I'm just trying to quickly get myself together. We've got limited time, so can I quickly ask that we just put a couple of photos up? That's my wife, Tammy, for those of you that don't know. For those of you that know her, she sends her love. And she's sorry that she can't be here, but you know, for those of you that know now, we've got four children. So getting into the car, going somewhere, is anything between an hour and a half and 4 hours. That's before we leave. So I said to her, you know, you stay with the circus at home and I'm going to have a break. So pray for her. You can put the next one on. That's Isabella. You guys remember, 10 years old. Isabella really wanted to be here this morning, but she needs to help her mom with the circus at home. So she sends her love to all her friends as well. And then the next one, that's Mia. That's one of our twins, 22 months old. She's an amazing little girl. God has done some amazing stuff in both our twins' health. Just about 2 weeks ago, we had some tests done to see if they've got leukemia, since we didn't know what was going on. They were very anemic and all kinds of stuff. But all the tests came back clear, which is just praise God for that. Amen. And something as simple as taking them off soya has changed their lives. They're new children. And so we're on this journey, trusting God for continuous healing in their life. That's Gracie. That's a sister. And as you can see, look at that face. They are just beautiful. You'll see me in all of those pictures together because I just want to make sure that you can see that they look like me and not like the mom. Okay? Okay, and then the next one. You guys remember Peyton? So we met Peyton at a safety home, and through some connections, you know, through some of the people in the church here, we met Peyton when she was 3 months old, and she was rescued, and God's done an amazing thing just as we managed to get her and have her with us. And we've had her now, she's now four, and I was so stirred. And you know, when we start speaking about children and when we start understanding that God does place the lonely in families, that He provides homes, that he loves us so much that He's not going to leave us alone. And you know what? The amount of need out there, if we're gonna look at the need, we're going to die. Because we're going to feel helpless and we're gonna give up. But we can make a difference, even if it's in one child's life. And I really want to say to you that if God is speaking to you around adoption, there are many in this church that I know that we know as friends that has got children. That has got the privilege of being given a child by God to raise them as your own, being the mom and dad. And I want to say that if that stirs in your heart and you're not sure how that is and can we even do it, I want you to go and speak to somebody that's adopted or fostering, because it is the most amazing gift that you can have. And I want to tell you that so many people think it's just for a chosen few, but God called us to be the family that would come and look after the children, His children. Amen. Good. So that was that. That's a family. Sure. Okay, we've gone through that. I want to read you scripture quickly. That as I was sitting there, I felt like for this missions month, as you guys starting off, the base of what we have to work from is going to have to be from love. And I mean, let me read to you out of 1 Corinthians 13 from verse 1. It says, if I speak, and I didn't give the scripture to them, so the fact that it's not on is my fault. If I speak in the tongues of men and angels, but do not have love, I'm a noisy gong and a clanging cymbal. Excuse me. And if I have a prophetic power and understanding of all mysteries and knowledge, and if I have all the faith so as to remove mountains, but have not have love, I am nothing. That scripture carries on. I want to say to you that if we want to reach out, when Jesus said to us, go into all nations and make disciples, that going comes on the back of where Jesus spent some time looking into the community, spending time with people. We have to be in our community. We have to look at what's going on in our community. We have to look far beyond just the four walls of our church. When we come here together, we come to be encouraged and we come to celebrate together and we come to be built up, and it's like halftime for us. You know, it's like when the guys come off the field, halftime. You know, and you get encouraged, you get something to drink, you get a bite to eat and you get built up, But the game is out there. You know, everything that we do around what Jesus says to us, that to go into the nations, is out there. So when we get together here, we have to look at the way that Jesus looked. And I want to read to you out of Matthew 9, quickly. 9 from verse 35. And Mark used it in our prayer time as well. And it says, Jesus traveled through all the towns and villages of that area, teaching in the synagogues and announcing the good news about the kingdom. And he healed every kind of disease and illness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were confused and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. He said to his disciples, the harvest is great. He didn't speak about the church, even though this is a great church. He spoke about the harvest out there is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord who is in charge of the harvest and ask him to send more workers into the field. People were on Jesus' mind. People matter to God. Everything about Jesus' work here on earth was around people. The very reason why he came was because of us, because of people. Because God so loved the world, God so loved the people, that he would send his son Jesus to come so that he can make a way for us. And when Jesus walked in his community, he didn't just walk and wave at the people. He saw with spiritual eyes what was going on. He looked at the crowd, and I'm pretty sure that as he looked at the crowd, not all of them looked harassed, and not all of them were downcast. It was a crowd of people that were there together, like this morning. There would be a crowd, and Jesus would walk in, and he would look at the crowd, and often we would look at our natural eyes, and we would go, when people are dressed well, and they drive a nice car, and they have a home, well, they must be doing well. And when they've got clothes that are torn, and they're dirty, and they don't have a home, it must go really bad with them. But I'm pretty sure that it was a crowd like this, ordinary people, that Jesus, when he was among them, he saw not just with his natural eyes, but he saw with the eyes of God. He saw with spiritual eyes. He could see beyond the clothes that they're wearing to try and hide the bruises of life and maybe even physical abuse. He could look beyond the makeup that they put on to try and hide the tears of the depression and the anxiety. You see, because when Jesus looks, he looks at the heart. And the heart, our hearts are revealed before him. And I think we often, it's not that we don't see what he sees. I think it's when we're in our community and we see what he sees, that it's so hard that we choose to look away. And I want to say to you that I'm not judging you this morning, because I'm one of those that when I see what's going on in the community, it's so hard and I don't know where to start, that I rather choose to look the other way. Because it's just too hard, especially if it comes to children. It's so hard for me when I see it, and I would rather look away until the day that God arrested my heart and he says, I want you to play a part in this. I want you to not run away from the pain of what's going on in the world, but I want you to run towards it. Because a Christian that runs towards the pain of this world, that's where his presence is. That's when the change starts to happen. That is when the manifest presence of God is being revealed here on earth. You and I want you to look at somebody next to you and say, you and I. I mean, you need to say it like you mean it, because it's really you and I. You see, some time ago when we moved to Setchfield, I mean, it was an amazing journey. Just that's 3 years now. It's almost, you know, in this month, it's 3 years ago that we left, and, you know, over the next month or so. And when we got there, you know, I was all excited, you know, because when God gives you a thing about reaching the community, you know, you get excited. Yeah. Nobody's putting their hand up, but they're shaking their heads. So I was excited to reach this town because, I mean, it's the most beautiful town in South Africa. I'm sorry, but it is. And for those of you that's not been there, you're missing out. It's an amazing place. But so I go into this town and I see the beauty of it, and I'm so excited because I know that God is wanting to do something great here, not because of me, but because he loves the community and he loves the people. Amen? Yes, that's true. Until I met the community. Jesus, help us, because they worship anything that's there. You know, there's guys that hug the trees and live for the trees and for the fairies, and we're known as a Sloan town, and we've got a tortoise that represents our town. The tortoises have got more right in our town than our children. Like, seriously. There'll be a dog in the car locked up. And people on a Saturday morning, for those of you guys that's been at the market, they will hunt you down and they will find you if your dog is in that car. But let there be a kid, they'll just look in and go, oh, that's a child, let's not worry about that, you know. So the reality is, this things are so messed up, because if we don't understand the value of what God places on people, you know, we start worshiping everything else, and we start forgetting God, and so it's a place where there's a very few Christians, those who serve God. And I felt God said to me and said to Tammy that we are here to pastor not just a church, but to pastor a community, whether they join the church or not. That makes a great slogan until you start walking that out. Until you start spending time with people and you realize that if God does not come through here, you know, because I pray and I beg and I try and be the best example that I can. but it's just not happening. And as I'm on this journey, I was desperate before God, and I asked him, how are we going to do this? How are we going to actually reach this community? Because I can't. And that's a good place to start, because we need God. We need him, and we need his strategy, and we need to hear what he is saying. But there needs to be a willingness in our heart to say, yes, God, here am I, send me. And so as I'm busy in this time praying, I feel God gave me this slogan. And I call it a slogan, and I hate that word slogan. But he gave me this phrase that probably changed my life and is still changing my life. And he says, I want you to create an environment for people to meet with Jesus. And I wrote it down, and I didn't exactly know what it meant. And as I was busy praying through it, the penny dropped. And I realized that I have tried. And when they meet John, nothing changes. When John sits and spends time with him, nothing changes. But when I sit with him in the moment and I introduce him to Jesus and they meet with him, that's where the change comes. In a moment meeting with Jesus. And I want to say what we do here is we create an environment for people to come and meet with Jesus. They're not just here to come and listen to nice songs and a great worship team, which by the way you have, and just appreciate it. Because just appreciate it. And you've got an amazing building, and appreciate it. And you've got all these things going on, and appreciate it. But in all of that, our motivation is, so for us back at home, our worship team, they know that they're not just there to lead people in a few songs. They're there to create an environment through song for people to meet with Jesus. Our children's church workers, they know that they are there not to babysit our children. They are there to create an environment for those children to meet with Jesus. Because the word says that when a child meets Jesus, when they're older, they won't depart from him. Even if they wander off. And I want to say to parents this morning, you need to trust God and hold on to that scripture for those of you that are trusting for your children to come back to God. That his word is truth. And that we need to trust it. When we raise our children in his ways, that they will not depart from it when they're older. For those sitting in the back which wonder now, why am I here? Because the kids are making a noise, and I don't know whether I should, you know, why I'm here, because I don't hear the messages. I want to say to you, be faithful and continue bringing them, because you're raising them in the ways of the Lord. And one day you can stand on the word of God. Amen. I want to tell you that if ever you want to see an amazing journey in God, you have to step out. You have to go out. You know, I think when we start taking care and interest in the community, that's when the community starts taking interest in us. When we start caring for them, they start wanting to know what the church's opinion is. And we've had a couple of things happening over the last little while in our community, and I want to share just this story with you. And some of you might have heard it on the news that some months back, 19 months ago now, in one of our neighborhoods in town, and I want to call it as it is, you know, in a white neighborhood, because often we expect murder in black neighborhoods, and by the way, and we need to start changing that mindset between black and white and different neighborhoods. But in a white neighborhood in Sedgefield, one of the ladies was busy cleaning windows and her gutters, and a neighbor came out the yard with a hammer, and he beats her to death right in front of a garage. And that was a shock to our community, because nothing like that has ever happened in our community. And I want to leave that story there, and I want to backtrack a little bit. So a year and a half before that, I joined what we call COP, Community Orientated Policing. It's a group of guys that in the community serve the community together with the police and the neighborhood watchers to try and make sure that, you know, just all the crime and stuff don't get out of hand in our beautiful town. And so I was asked if I would join through some stuff that I've done before. And I said to them, I'll join. And as I joined, none of the guys on the team are saved. And I knew that. And I was excited about that. And I remember as I got onto this team, one of the guys said to me, as long as you don't try and convert me. And I was like, no, I'm not going to do that. And then one of the other guys, which was the toughest guy there, he said to me, I don't like it that you're here. And I... You know, that's quite a welcome. And I said, you know, but why? He says, because every time I use the F word and it's not faith, he says, I'm feeling this thing and I don't like it. I don't like it, you know. So I said to him, that's between you and whoever, you know, but I'm here to come and serve our community. And he says to me, and by the way, I want you to know that I'm never going to put my foot in your church. And I said, that's fine as well, you know. And we started serving together, and we have a lot of fun together. And I'm there with a mission, you know, greater than just fighting crime. And it's wonderful. And this gentleman runs a pub in our town, and it's more like the English pubs, you know, it's more of a family restaurant type of pub. It's not, you know, just, you know, all the negative stuff that goes with that. So there's a lot of families hanging around here, but he runs this. Now, the chef of this place, it's his mom that was killed. And this man that said to me that I don't like it that you're here, I will never put my foot in your church, gives me a call, and he says to me, will you do the funeral? And I said, obviously, I'll do that. And then he said to me, I'm going to have to work closely with you with this because I'm gonna pay for the funeral and all the arrangements. And I said, that's fine. 2 days later, he phones me and he says to me, Jean, I need to speak business with you. And I'm like, yeah, you know what? What's going on? He says, no, church business. Come on, God. And so we met together and we arranged this whole thing. Now, I want to say to you that it's in the midst of this incredible tragedy, but God says that he turns things around and that he will reach people, man, in whatever situation, as long as we're available and as long as we listen and as long as we're aware of what he's busy doing. So I'm there serving them and serving, you know, whoever I can in this thing. And on the day that I did the funeral or the memorial service, we can see 220 people. We had 210 people in our building. 10 of those were people that served Jesus. No, let me say that again. 210 people there, only 10 of them served Jesus. 200 people from our community was there because we were available. And I'm not saying this because I'm great. Mark asked me to share a couple of stories. That's why I want to share it to you. I want to encourage you this morning that wherever it is that God is calling you in, make sure that you are there, serve them and love them, because I can say stuff, but if I don't really love my community, it's not going to carry any weight. I'm just going to be a glonging symbol. I had an opportunity to share around forgiveness to 200 people that don't know Jesus. I think that is pretty awesome, that God would make a way like that for us. And here this guy with his wife is sitting in our church. And since then we meet, we do all of our neighborhood watch meetings and with the police and the partnering guys around the crime. We meet at church. We've got a little coffee shop with a scripture on the wall, which I didn't even think of when I read that scripture now, out of 1 Corinthians that says, love is patient and kind. So when they sit there and we discuss these things, we're sitting in church, nobody swears in that meeting. Now, I was a part of that meeting for 6 months before that. I want to tell you that you had to wash everything when you walked out there. Now, there's not one swear word that gets spoken in that thing. Praise God for that. I love it. And every time this guy walks in, I walk over to him, and we've become really close friends. And I walk over to him, and I say to him, welcome to church. Isn't God amazing? You see, because God loves them so much, and that we have put such a judgment on those who don't know Jesus in our community, that we are waiting for them to be perfect before they come through those doors. And those doors need to be open to anyone that wants to come through there, because they need to meet Jesus here. Because unfortunately, some of us are not always the best representation of Jesus out there. And I want to ask you, can we continuously work in our relationship with Jesus? When I say work, I don't mean try and do stuff. I'm talking about being with Jesus, reading his word, spend time in prayer, those basic principles, Christian principles of spending time with him, so that I can hear him, so that I can know what his mandate is for me for the day. You know, when we really love someone, we are consumed by them, like when we date, you know, when we first dated. And for those of you guys that are dating, you can't think of anything else but that person that you're in love with. We need to live like that with Jesus, because that's how he is with us. He's in love with us. He thinks of us, and not just us, but he thinks of those who are in the world that don't yet know him. People matter to him. People are on his mind, and it should be on our mind. As people matter to him, they should matter to us. It should be the thing when we wake up in the morning, it should be not just what am I going to go and do today for work or anything else, but what people, God, are you going to bring across my path? And I want to say to you that it's not to preach at them, and if God gives you an opportunity, do it and do it well. Make sure you know the scriptures. But it's about loving the people with the love of Jesus. You know, I have tried to close the deal on getting the prayer prayed, the sinner's prayer prayed, so much that I have messed up, I think, many a times the process God has taken people on. Because it's a process. God walks with them. And I think for some reason we felt like if I can just pray the prayer, I've got another one in my pocket, then at the end I can go with a little list like I've prayed for 55 people this past year and they now know Jesus. But the reality is the timing might not be right. The timing might not be right. So I have changed and have taken off the responsibility and the weightiness I felt around the responsibility of praying the prayer, rather to get to the responsibility around loving them and creating moments for them to meet with Jesus. And then if I don't pray for them and Mark prays for them or somebody else, I can still rejoice because at the end, it's not about the prayer that's prayed with them. It's about the process that's been walked with them. Somebody has sown seeds in these lives. And then when we pray with them and the moment is right, then we think we've done it. And we need to change because ultimately it's only Jesus that can change your heart. And we need to be able to work together and go, God, we want to partner with you, not you with me. I have got a list of people. This morning when Mark said, pray for that one person. Man, I've got a long list. I'm in Sedgefield. I've got a long list. And I couldn't mention all of them. I just have to say when I pray for them, God, you know the list because there's a long list. And because I love them, I think of them often. And it means that I phone them regularly. It means that I see them. It means that in my times with God, I cry out to him. You know, I don't have to go and work myself up to pray for the lost. I've got these guys that become my friends. I don't want them to go to hell. I don't want them to go to, you know what I'm saying? I love them. And I love Jesus. And I know that Jesus loves them so much more. What would Jesus have us do? What would Jesus have me do this morning? And that's the thing that Mark was saying is that I'm not going to ask you this morning, would you get involved? Would you look into your community? I'm going to ask Jesus, the Lord of the harvest, that he will move our hearts. Because you know what? When he said that to his disciples, he knew that no man can change another man's heart towards reaching out. He knew how stubborn we can be. Amen? No, there's a few more that need to say amen. I know some of you. No, but it's true. You know, only Jesus can. And so this morning our prayer needs to be, God, would you help us change our hearts in order for us to reach out? Because if it's going to be dependent on me, I want to tell you that when I get in the car here and I drive down the road, if it's dependent on me, it's not going to happen. But when I get in the car and I say, God, would you show me? Would you help me? Would you turn my heart? Would you soften my heart? See what can happen. I want to quickly read you out of Luke 19, verse 1 to 10. This is really hot up here. I get really excited. Jesus entered Jericho, made his way through the town. There was a man named Zacchaeus. He was the chief tax collector in the region, and he had become very rich. He tried to get a look at Jesus, but he was too short to see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed up the sycamore tree beside the road when Jesus went by. When Jesus came by, he looked up at Zacchaeus and called him by name. Zacchaeus, he said, quick, come down. I must be a guest in your home today. Zacchaeus quickly climbed down and took Jesus to his house with great excitement and joy. But the people were displeased. I want to say to you that when you care for the community and when you start looking at your neighbors and those that are unsaved, when you start spending time with them and you start reaching out to them and you start inviting them to a braai with your other Christian friends, there's going to be some people that's going to be displeased with you. Then you can ask them to be displeased somewhere else. Because get the Christian friends that are there that says, we are not just here for each other. That we are here for a community and for our neighborhood and for our metro to come to know Jesus. That's why we are here. We are a family and a people on mission. I'm just not here to have a bride, to have a Joel. I can have a bride and a Joel and be a good Christian with non-Christians with me at my house. Sorry. Invite them to your house. It's a better place. But the people were displeased because he had gone to be a guest of a notorious sinner. They grumbled. Meanwhile, Zacchaeus stood before the Lord and said, I will give half of my wealth to the poor. And that, those who I have cheated with their taxes, I will give four times. You see what happens when people come into the presence of Jesus, when they meet with Jesus, a stingy thief becomes a generous giver. That's what happens when people meet with Jesus. In that moment, Jesus didn't challenge him on it. But he knew in the presence of Jesus. I want to close with this story. So I'm at this pub visiting this friend of mine, and we're just discussing some of our security stuff, and his wife walks in, and she says, and he said to me that the lady that works for them, apparently she gets charged 10% to belong to a church. So I said, here's an opportunity. So I said, no, let me tell you how this works. They don't get charged, but they call it tithing. And he says, okay, tell me about it. And I'm sitting, and while I'm sitting there chatting with him about it, a couple of the guys that was at the funeral, I'm now their pastor. They don't come to our church, but they call me pastor or rabbi or father. And I'm sitting there, and one of the guys go like, hey, there's our pastor. And everybody's excited, and a couple of beers came now. We just send it back because everybody is hospitable. You see, what happens is when people find family, they get generous. When people see Jesus, they become generous. But in any case, so then you send it back. But here I'm sitting chatting with him. And as I'm working, the steward team, his wife, Rife, she's Jewish. And she says, so what are you guys talking about? And he says, no, he's telling me about this thing that they charge 10% to belong to a church. I said, no, it's tithing. He says, that thing. And she says, I said to her, but why don't you sit here? And she says, no, I can't because I'm a sinner. You know what happened in that moment? I was thinking this. There was a Christian somewhere that said to her that she's a sinner, which is truth, you know, but that made her feel that she cannot take a part of anything of God. And I said to her, no, don't worry, come sit here. I know your husband, he's a greater sinner, so come sit here. I actually did say that, and they thought it was funny. And she believed, so she came and sat. And I started telling them around tithing and around generosity. And a couple of the guys are saying, listen, what are you guys talking about? And he says, no, you're speaking about finances in the church. And then we drew a crowd. And I did a finance teaching, a generous tithing, finance, church teaching in the pub over 10, 15 minutes with a whole bunch of guys that is on a journey that they don't know that they need Jesus, but he knows that he does. And what he does is he creates an environment wherever we go. You need to know that. Where you go, you need to create an environment for people to meet with Jesus. Now, I'm not advocating start a pub ministry. Please hear me. Because I know how this thing goes. Everybody's going to... That's not what I'm saying. It so happened that I was in the pub discussing these things. But wherever you go, in your workplace, in your neighborhood, with your neighbor, wherever, create an environment around where you are for people to meet with Jesus in the way that you love them, in the way that you care for them, in the way that you take interest, in the way that you're a representation of who Jesus is in your life. Let's close our eyes. We don't have time for a song that I wanted to play, but I want to read you the lyrics and I want you to go listen to it. It's a song from Rent Collective and it says, no outsiders. And it says, you are our refuge. You have no borders. When I was a stranger knocking at your door, you took me in. With no questions and no conditions. When I was a sinner running from your grace, you called me friend. There are no outsiders to your love. We are all welcome. There's grace enough. When I have wandered, Lord, your cross is the open door. There are no outsiders. I am not an outsider to your love. You are the harbor in every tempest. When my soul was shipwrecked, tossed upon the waves, you calmed the storm. You are the Father, and there are no orphans. Every tribe and nation gathered in your arms, singing with one voice. There are no outsiders to your love. We are all welcome. There's grace enough. I was tired, I was poor, I was thrown upon the shores, I was homeless, I was afraid, till I heard you call my name. Now I'm ransomed, I'm restored, I'm resurrected, I'm yours, I'm loved, yes, I belong. Oh, my soul has found its home. Jesus might call them through a miracle by his voice, but I want to say to you that 90% of the time, he's going to call them by your voice. By my voice, and not as the pastor, but as a child of God. Because first and foremost, I'm not a pastor, I'm a child of God. I'm a believer, I love Jesus. Can I ask that we stand for a moment? Because, no, I want you to sit. We're going to do this right. because it's too easy to get everybody to stand and say that if you really want to be used by God, and if you say that count me in, and I'm here, just for everybody to stand. Because you know what? There's people's lives at stake. And that person that you were thinking of when Mark was saying earlier that you need to pray for them, I believe that God is going to stir your heart and God is going to add to that list, and you're going to find yourself in the next week and 2 weeks and month in here, start praying in a way that you've never prayed for the lost before. Not because of a message, but because you know how much God loves them. And you know what? It's time that we start remembering what Jesus saw in us before we served Him. The amazing grace that He had for us. So if you say that I want to be a part of that, that I want to be able to reach out and I want to trust God for the vehicle, whatever that might look like as we prayed before in the cotton day of prayer, whatever that might look like in order to reach people, in order to bring people into a family, and for people to come to meet Jesus and to be a part of what God's busy doing here right now, I want you to stand and I want to pray for you. And I want you to, before God, ask Him and say that when I stand, I'm serious and I really want to be used. I don't want to just leave here thinking it's a great idea and then by Monday I forgot. Father, my prayer for those that are standing, Lord, is that You will speak to us. Father, that You are the Lord of the harvest, that You are the only one that can change our hearts, Lord. We acknowledge this morning how hard it is to have our hearts changed, to be able to have compassion, to be moved, to look at a community and see people beyond what they're wearing, beyond the makeup, beyond the cars that they drive, but that we would start seeing them with the eyes of Jesus, that we would start seeing the hope that they need, which is You, Lord, that we will see the abuse that is happening that they're trying to hide, that we will understand the anxiety, Father, that's going on, and that we can create an environment for them to meet with You, Jesus. And if You want to use us, God, which I know You do, Lord, that You would help us to be obedient. Would You give us what we need, Father? And You said that You've given us everything we need for life and godliness. Lord, may we be aware. May we have the boldness. But more than that, Lord, may we have the love. In Jesus' name.